Okay,
Start
let me start the presentation.
Okay, sir.
So very good afternoon, everyone. So I take this pleasure to share my experience with you all. So I learned that many people from the different part of the country you have come to this particular course, and you are in the last session. It's looks. I'm very happy to see many people, and I am seeing the chat window that. So you have gone through 5 days of the blockchain fundamentals, techniques, and many of the applications of the blockchain also. So I was supposed to share some of the recent trends in the blockchain. Though I have not worked with the blockchain, but however, we had an expertise to work on this. And what I thought is, okay, I will take some research papers on the blockchain, because this is one of the recent techniques everyone is working on this. And let me start with my presentation. And you can have feedback on the chat window. I will look into this. One minute, I will just go through it. Hope I am visible to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you. So let me share some of my ideas with this recent trends and issues with the blockchain. Where I start with the little bit review of what you are already learned, so that we can have a continuity of our discussion with the next 1.5 hour discussion. And the review of blockchain and its applications are very, very long way to go. You have gone through the topics at a in-depth level, and you are ready to read the recent issues in the blockchain. That is why I took 3 international journal papers in this topic. Therefore, that I want to share with you. Okay. Before that, let me have a review of the whatever you have discussed, so that I will try to link with the topic with the papers also. Okay. The blockchain is a constantly growing ledger. Of course, it goes with the hyperledger also, which keeps a permanent record of all the transactions that have been taken place in a secure, chronological, and immutable way. These are the key terms. So it's a permanent record. It is supposed to be secure, and it is a chronological in the sense whatever goes first that comes out, and immutable. Nobody can tamper it. The default blockchain is time reduction, unchanged.
Sir, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, feel free, it's not visible, sir.
Oh, it's not visible. Sorry. Is it visible? Karthikeyan? Is it visible for everyone?
Still, it is loading, sir. We haven't seen the first page, but it is showing like presentation.
So the presentation is visible to you?
Yeah, presentation is visible, but
sorry,
we haven't seen the slide.
So I'm moving the slides. Are you able to see?
Now it is visible, sir.
Now it is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. So the blockchain, it has evolved in the different steps. Is blockchain 1.0 is for meant for the currency purpose, and blockchain 2.0 is smart contract, and blockchain 3 is a decentralized application. This is what it has gone through and different evolution. And Bitcoin mining is used to securely and verify transaction to the rest of the network. So these are the highlights of the points. Just I will spend some 15 minutes to the fundamentals. That is for the continuity of our discussion. There is a term called miner, a group of people, and they process and confirm the transaction. The Bitcoin is created by rewarding these miners for their work in solving the mathematical and cryptographic problems. And of course, is a 256 hash function is the key point in the blockchain architecture, and a block has an ID, a nonce, data, hash, and a link to the previous and the next record. Nonce is the number used once, a hash that must have its leading 4 digits to be 0. Every record in the distributed ledger has a timestamp and unique cryptographic signature. That is why we call it as, when you work with the blockchain, the ledgers are ordered in chronological order. You can have a timestamp and you can go through it. Each change in the ledger should be subjected to vote by consensus algorithm. That means nobody is owner for the blockchain and nobody is the user. So anybody who comes and they can make use of it, and the technology also, it has not come to the open and to the Indian market. Of course, it is not so popular, but it is trying to come in the different way through different applications. There are 4 components of the blockchain. There is a software component. Cryptography is the very important component in the blockchain, and the hardware, which is supported by sophisticated hardware and power. And the requirement for the blockchain is hardware wise, the heavy requirement is there. Storage is heavy requirement is there, and there should be a basic mining. That means there is a race to find the solution to become the winner. Who is the winner that takes the block and make it valid? Okay. And the blockchain is characterized by disintermediated. It works in peer-to-peer network. Okay. It is not a centralized, very important, and it works on the peer-to-peer network, distributed, decentralized, and is a trustless. Very important thing of the blockchain is a trustless, because when you have a trust, automatically you are depending on somebody. But since there is no boss, no owner, so everything is the peer-to-peer network. Okay. And it is supposed to be a trustless, but because of, we have the ledger which is owned by everyone. So I want to give something to you, so you also want to give something to me. So we have a mutual understanding that everyone, we make a entry in the ledger, so that nobody can deny afterwards, yes, I have not been access to the environment like this. Okay. So the blockchain technology fixes 3 things that the internet was not designed. Okay. So I will say that the internet is something like a syntax space. So we have the syntax and we fix everything. Therefore, whoever is working with the internet, they have no semantic information. So we do not have value, and we do not have trust, and there is no reliability when you are working with the internet. For example, somebody who sit in front of computer and they may log in, and afterwards if they move, the same environment will be continuing. So you do not have any reliability on the internet world. But the blockchain technology, these are the 3 things which are fixed by the blockchain technology, okay, which is not available in the internet. That is the basic requirements. So, of course, there are blockchain started with the intention of cryptocurrency. So these are the different currencies. Cryptocurrencies are used: Bitcoin, Litecoin, Reserve Cash, and Monero and Dash. Okay, and blockchain is basically is a decentralized autonomous organization or decentralized autonomous corporation. Okay, that's what I said. It's a nobody is a owner. Okay. Rules encoded as a computer program called smart contracts. Okay, as we have discussed in the earlier slide, that see smart contract is the basic requirement of the blockchain at the second level. So the limitations of the blockchains are, there is a lack of awareness, very important. Nobody is to ready to work with the blockchain except you. Okay, and even we conducted one more course on the expected some participants in the blockchain earlier in the last month. So we did not get enough people, especially. So people are not aware of the blockchain. Recently, last 3 to 4 months, there are a lot of the advertisements are coming in the blockchain because the industry senses the need for the blockchain for a different purpose applications, and there is a limited availability of technical talent. Okay, so you can see some, you can Google it, see the requirement of the blockchain people. Heavy demand is there, blockchain people. Somehow it has not pierced through the market or pierced through the people. Okay, and it is immutable. Whatever you design, it cannot be undo. Key management. So the basic requirement is everyone is having a keys, and these keys must be properly managed. And the component of the key management is you generate the key, distribute the key, ensure that keys are not going to a wrong person. Okay, and these key managements are going in a long way to manage it. And the scalability. The scalability means the blockchain, as you are aware, that it starts with a ledger. The ledger can be linked with somebody else's ledger, and that can be linked with somebody else's ledger, and so on. Okay, as long as the people are there, the people may have more than one link with the blockchain operations. Okay, that means I have one account which is assigned with some information, and I have another account which that is also assigned with some other information. Like this, it is supposed to be scalable, and all these blockchain operations are based on consensus mechanism. So earlier we say that a block can be created in every 10 minutes. This 10 minutes is important to ensure that the block is valid. And there are some attacks related to the blockchain. Okay, before that, there is a difference between the physical currency and offline currency and online currency. The offline currencies are nothing but the physical currency. Okay, therefore double spending is not possible. If I have a coin or if I have a currency, I will spend it in a hotel. Let me say the hotel, you cannot get it back. Okay, that means I have even the actual currency. Okay, but in the case of the online or is a digital cash, double spending is possible. However, Bitcoin transactions have the possibility of being copied and broadcasted. It opens up the possibility that the same Bitcoin could be spent twice by its owner. Okay, these are the things which have to be taken care of. And there is one more thing. There is the Bitcoin fork. Or is something similar to the fork means it is creating one more link. Okay, separate chain and path is formed. Sort the subfork introduces a change which is backward compatible. Hard fork introduces a change that forces everyone to upgrade the software. Segregated protocol upgrade that changes the structure of Bitcoin transaction data. And basically, the Merkle trees keep track of all the transaction in the blockchain. And of course, depending on the people who have joined, the blockchain may be a very, very, very lengthy. It may be a challenging one for the people to work and to people to mine and also to people keep track of the transaction. So very over the time, I visualize that the blockchain will evolve in such a way that many people will be a part of the blockchain. The reason is nowadays we are all working in a digital environment. Everything we have digitized. Okay, therefore once you go into the internet world, so obviously you have to work on the some kind of contract. So I can tell you like, so there are contracts for every digital operation. We are encountering some contract as we are working with the physical contract. Okay, a contract is something like a, there will be agent who will be given with the specification. Yes, maybe a vegetable contract, or it is a bank also can be given a contract, or the some work can be given as a contract. Okay, because a contract is actually basically based on some kind of specification. The specification must be well documented, and it must be our many people must be aware of all these things, and you cannot violate the specification. And if there are some violations also, that there will be some kind of penalties, or there may be some kind of what you can say is adjustment. All this must be properly adhered, and it must be documented. Therefore, there is a need for a protocol to keep track of all these things. Okay. The Merkle trees keep track of the transaction. As you are going through the blockchain evolution, there is a basic thing is a transaction. The transaction is either it is committed or it is not at all committed. That means once you do a transaction with the blockchain, that will be immutable. Apart from the blockchain, it is a regular usage. There are some attacks on the blockchain that we call as the Bitcoin mitigating attacks. There are many, many attacks will be there in the future. We cannot give away all these things. That is why the researchers are coming. Basically, you are all working with the, what you can say is the SA algorithm. There is a 256-bit algorithm, okay? And you cannot cheat a person, or you cannot demand something, otherwise you don't claim anything like, okay? But however, there are so far many kind of attacks are there. Though the ledger is going to be a foolproof, but there will be definitely some kind of attacks, because we know, we do not know who will be involved with this and who will be being attacked at all. Okay, the first attack is a civil attack. That means low, so many people are there in the blockchain. Okay, you have to make a, in order to make a civil attack, you have to gain majority of the influence in the network. That is very difficult to identify. You do not know how do you gain influence in the whole network. I don't have an influence in the network because it is a peer-to-peer. Therefore, that attack is difficult to identify. Race attack. Okay, race attack in the sense, it requires the recipients to accept it. Accept as unconfirmed transaction as a payment. And Fini attack, a kind of double spending problem. Double spending problem in the sense, okay, you spend it and you spend the same coin to some other place also, which is not at all possible. But even if it is possible, it will be taken care of. Then Vector 776 attack is a combination of race and Fini attacks. And 50%, 51% attack, that means trying to control more than 50% computing resources. Who sets the Bitcoin price? This is a very big question for the people who are working on the Bitcoin. Simple answer is, the more demand means there is a less supply. More supply means there is a less demand. So the items or entities who are having a less demand, so the price goes down. And there is a more demand is there, and there is a less supply is there, the price goes up. So all it is a gaming in the blockchain. That the government or the association of government or many people who are involved in the policy, so they have to govern all these things to maintain the price. Okay, also we say that the price of the Bitcoin is very, very, very volatile. There is uncertainty of future Bitcoin's value. There is a reason that the blockchain has not matured for a enough technological level. How to choose the Bitcoin wallet? These are the ways to do it. That means first you should have a knowledge of the Bitcoin. Then you have to choose your wallet. For that, you get an address. Then address is equivalent to a mail address or any address which is unique to you. And there must be a public and private key for the people to work on this. And you can have a getting the Bitcoin and spending the Bitcoin. These are the possible ways of doing it. How to choose Bitcoin wallet? Okay. As the blockchain is based on fully software, okay, you get a wallet either through mobile or through the desktop or through the hardware or through the web. So we may say that the web wallet is one of the popular blockchain technology, and also you can have a desktop, but mostly it is dominated by the mobile. So to select a reliable Bitcoin wallet, one should judge it based on the following criteria. Either it is a hard wallet or a cold wallet. Hard wallet in the sense it is online storage. So cold wallet means it is an offline storage. And you should have a control over the private keys. The wallet where you own and control your keys. And backup and security features are the other important selection process. Okay, here you can see backup keys and bin codes. Developer community, it is an active development community for maintenance. Unfortunately, currently there are not much involved people who are there in the blockchain developer. And compatibility, it can be compatible with different operating system, and of course mainly Linux based systems are made compatible. And it is a HT wallet. It is a wallet that generates new addresses itself. It is evolving over the time, and wallet that does not require KYC. So sending and receiving the Bitcoin, to start with that, that means we are more talking on the currency. There is a Bitcoin based on the blockchain 1.0. Okay. And sending and receiving the Bitcoin, it involves some steps. Log into your wallet, go to send and receive icon, choose whether you want to send or receive Bitcoin, and send the Bitcoin. So either the public address of the recipient or choose the amount which you want to send. Once you decide the amount, confirm the amount to avoid mistakes. Then click on send transaction and verify the transaction. And last time for confirming your public address and sender's public address. And finally, you can receive the Bitcoin, for which you need to share your public wallet address with the sender. You can also do this by letting them scan a QR code. These are the ways of sending and receiving the Bitcoin. Okay, these are the review of the blockchain technology that we can think of it. Now, having the so many features with the blockchain, what could be the next step? Who can contribute to the blockchain? What are the applications which will be beneficial out of the blockchain? Okay, as you are going through the literature in a different way, one of the applications will be the blockchain will be more useful for the contract maintenance. So I just have a small break and look into your feedback. Any yes? Okay, I continue with this. Yes. So as I am going through the some of the literature on the blockchain and its role in the different domains. So one of the blockchain applications or the role of blockchain in the IoT services. So you know what is IoT. So there are a lot of sensors there. Sensors are receiving these signals, okay, in a different way, and the data coming from the sensing devices are pooled at your local locations. And of course, the purpose of the sensing data is to be accessible to all. Accessible to all means nowadays the IoT based system, they are making all their data ready for accessible to all. So therefore, there is a need for a cloud computing or cloud storage. Okay, even you can go through the many of the industry people. Okay, they read the sensing and they keep on sending it to the cloud. So this is always a trend between centralization, decentralization, which I have gone through for so many years, starting from the mainframe computer, dumb computers. That's the client side. And thereafter, the client server computing architecture was used. Thereafter, again, the thick computer concept was introduced. Thereafter, there was something like peer-to-peer computers. Okay, so after the introduction of the internet world, okay, people are thinking that there is a server, one level server, there is a tier one server, tier two server, tier three servers. Like you have a client at the one side, the server at the other side. The servers are also changing over the time. It's a thick server, thin server, okay, or thin client. The six servers are over the time, it has become a cloud. Okay, so this is going through the years at a different phenomenal rate. Like, okay, I know these technologies are known to me for the past 37 years. Okay, especially I have gone through the technology growth over the year from 1990 onwards. Okay, because that time only the computer was very popular. There are so many changes are there. Okay, so now we have come up to the end. That is, every data, whatever you want to give, is going to be stored in the cloud. Okay, there is a big paradigm shift in the usage of the data. Earlier, the data was with the people only. Afterwards, it was shared. Now there is a cloud providers are there. They receive the data, and the data are going to be distributed across the people on demand. Okay, here also there are so many research issues are there. Like, yeah, the cloud data deduplication is one of the research issue. Okay, deduplication in the sense you don't want to repeat, and so many data are repeated, redundant information is there. Therefore, they try to do a deduplications. Okay, so many items are there in the backend. Now, what happens? Everyone wants to get connected to the cloud. That means cloud receive data and render information. Okay, so what is the need for the central place? Because everyone is able to view, store, okay, access with, of course, access control. But over the time, it was felt that by even a simple IoT devices, I have to take all the data from the IoT at the edge to the cloud. Therefore, there is a need for a traffic. So many people, they started pumping the data into the cloud. So who knows whether the cloud will be limitless or will be really a cloud. Okay, therefore, there was a need for making some kind of assistant to the people who are processing the data at the cloud. Okay, so all the way you have to go to the cloud, then process it and get the result back. So there was a need for, okay, I will demarcate my area. Okay, whatever the storage at the cloud, I can do it there. Whatever the processing I have to do, I will do it at my level. That means I am working in a college environment. I want to store my data in the, let us say, in the cloud. But some of the small changes I want to make it. So I don't want to change all the way to the cloud, where it has to be consistent in their operations. Therefore, some of the data can be processed at the local level, that we call as edge computing. Okay, there is a edge computing is the computing which is done at the edge of the network. Okay, the other name for the edge computing is called fog computing. Okay, therefore the fog computing is the recent trends people are working on this. That means whatever the IoT, that is a Internet of Things, okay, whatever the data we see from, that is being processed at the edge level or at the client level. Then if it is okay, then only it is stored in the cloud level. That is what towards a scalable public blockchain. That is a blockchain plays a role in fog computing of the IoT services computing. Okay. So basically I want to say that it's a services. So services means you can have a different technologies. So normally there is what we call as the government says about we are providing goods, and afterwards you are providing services also. That is why the GST comes. Okay. Therefore, the IoT kind of services are going to be across the world. Okay. Now you want to deploy the fog computing in the IoT services, and which is computed. Okay. Therefore, there is a paper called Group Chain, which is towards a scalable public blockchain in fog computing of IoT services computing. Okay, the scope of this particular work is wider acceptance of smart devices in the network world. Smart devices are always a common terminology people are using. Smart devices, group of devices put together, smart home, group of home put together, smart street, and group of streets put together, smart town, and group of smart towns put together, smart state. That is the way people are thinking of. So over the time, what happened? We will become smart world. Okay. So smart in the sense you are adding some kind of intelligence. Therefore, here there is a link between the devices and which is to be empowered with the intelligence. Okay. Therefore, when you say it is intelligent, it is supposed to be the active device. Okay. It is not only data reading and data writing. It is active device. So when you say it is an intelligent device, I always tell the concept of you are able to separate them. So if there are people from Tamil Nadu, I can say intelligent, na, you call it as a paguttarivu. You want to divide and you want to conquer. That means whatever is the big items that you are dividing and you want to analyze, that becomes an intelligence. Okay. The word intelligent, it comes from three terminologies. There is a clustering, classification, and association. So if you look at all these three words, okay, everything can be brought under these three words. Okay, therefore the smart devices, okay, it has the intelligent mechanism built into that. Okay, that is going to give some kind of service to the computing world. Okay, therefore the IoT provides service computing for massive data from devices. And fog computing, which is an extension of the decentralized and distributed requirements. Hence, the blockchain comes into the picture. The reason is the blockchain having similar characteristics like security, privacy, scalability, okay, non-tampering, all these things are possessed, all these are the characteristics of blockchain, okay, that comes into picture. Therefore, the IoT in the deployment have to be appropriately separated out. That means smart devices, they are sending data to the cloud, and the cloud is receiving data. All the intermediate devices, okay, we call it as a fog node. All the intermediate devices, they communicate to each other, and finally this data is sent to the cloud. So during the intermediate devices, there is a need for contract. Yes, for example, if I send a data to a neighbor station, now there should not be any dispute in the receiving of the data. Okay, if it is a dispute, so obviously as a blockchain person, I will show, oh, this is what you have made an entry in the ledger. I also made an entry. Therefore, you cannot do with this. Like this, there is a extension of decentralization and distributed requirement is making the fog computing to exploit the blockchain activities. Okay. And also it expands the application scope of IoT. Okay, there are many IoT scope is there. So obviously we'll say that Internet of Things means it is not only the small devices or the sensors. These are all dealing with many of the things. That's what really it speaks the Internet of Things. But people who are working with the Internet of Things, they must have some kind of the contract in sending and receiving. Okay. Therefore, basically the blockchain can have working with the contract based operations. Okay. That means everyone, we are working with a trustless system. Okay. And of course, the world has become like this. We are working with a trustless system. Therefore, there is a need for a proof. Okay. For example, if I am having a money, I depend on a bank to keep my money in a safe. Therefore, these banks are governed by government or they have a collaborative work. Right. Over the time, I am very sure that the bank operations, everything will be automated by means of the blockchain. And of course, there are some social issues are also there. Okay, that is why people are waiting for their deployment of the blockchain in the some public domain. Okay. Now, again, the key issues with the fog computing are, okay, scalability. How far you can go ahead? How many people get involved with the blockchain? How you can extend it further? This is the issue with the scalability. Okay, that is why the paper which is published in the year 2020 in April month, they have contributed a work towards scalable public blockchain in fog computing of IoT computing. Okay, the role of group chain. So they have a group chain. Okay, chain is there, blockchain is there, but group chain. So group chain employs the leader group to collectively commit blocks for higher transaction efficiency. Okay, the reason is as the blockchains are going on, the transaction efficiency may come down. And introduces the bonus and deposit into the incentive mechanism to supervise the behaviors of members in the leader group. Group chain retains the security of it maintains the security of Bitcoin like blockchain and enhances the defense against attacks such as double spend and selfish mining. Okay, these are the issues already existing. Okay, the need for IoT and cloud. The IoT enables more effective control over the physical world through interconnected smart devices in manufacturing, in healthcare, in energy, in supply chain management, and CRM also. Okay, these are all part of the cloud. Now, because of the introduction of the blockchain, everything will be completely automated. Since you are all working on the trustless system, there is a need for making the trust among the people, and nobody can claim any further discrepancies in their kind of operations. Okay. So the fog computing and the blockchain, these are all going to be integrated with this particular research work. The fog computing relies on fog nodes to create cloud services. Fog computing suffers from the risk of trust based and centralized management. All the so far, all fog computings are having some kind of trust on the central management, but now we cannot have any trust. That's a problem, because anyone who is there, maybe a Google or the Yahoo or the Facebook or any people who are offering the services, can we have a trust? I think there is a big question. Okay, but there is a data needs to be transferred from one to another through the trusted intermediate people. That means having the data privacy and security. So finally, what I can say is, wherever you want to go for the decentralization of work, so I want my data to be private, I want my data to be secure. Okay, even in some cases, the administrators may disclose sensitive data. Examples: healthcare, finance. Okay, finance is very important. Healthcare also is important for the not disclosure. Okay, somebody don't want, I don't want my health information to be revealed to others. Therefore, these are the sensitive data which will be attacked even by insider. There can be insider attack or outsider attack. Anyhow, outsider attack can easily escape from them. Okay, because I have the credential. Nobody can come into the picture. But the insider attack, we are supposed to be careful. For a more scalable and secure, large scale IoT network, it is supposed to be exchanged. It is supposed to exchange and process the data autonomously in the trustless environment. This is what these people are addressing it. And a better mechanism is required for data security and privacy. For the scalability challenges, fog computing demands limited devices, and hence fog computing and blockchain are going together. You have the fog computing separately, blockchain separately, but unfortunate thing is, fog computing has a centralized mechanism, and fortunately, blockchains are having decentralized mechanism. Therefore, when you try to link the blockchain with the fog computing, whatever the difficulties of the decentralized mechanism will be overcome. That is why these two are together is justified. So the group chain employs the leader group with their small size to reach the consensus on blocks. So we want to have a consensus, but when you want to have a consensus on the blocks, okay, it's difficult to work with a very big size. That is why group chain employs the leader group. There is a leader group with a small size to reach the consensus. To achieve high transaction efficiency and guarantee dynamic membership under public environment. Okay, you want to go for a high transaction efficiency. So very the sorry side from the blockchain is, there is no limitation for the people who join and who leave. Anyhow, if they have a proper transaction, the transaction efficiency must be good. Okay, and there is no limited person. You cannot limit it over the time. Definitely, there will be a question: who will govern this? Okay, what kind of the bottlenecks are there in the blockchain? Okay, So here you can make up forks while preserving efficient transaction processing. Group chain is enhanced with a two chain structure. Normally people we have the single chain, though it looks like a single chain, like in academic we will say the linked list, but of course it is a two-way linked list or multi-way linked list. Okay, the linked list node, everyone has the ID and their previous information, the transaction, and some kind of the link with others. Okay, this is what has been drawn as a tree, the Merkle tree, like a phenomenon is drawn as a tree, but it is visualized as a chain. Internally they are looking as a different tree like structure, but it is logically visualized as a chain. There is a blockchain, but here as the strength grows, okay, there is a the fork is also required. That is a it make a fork while preserving efficient transaction processing. Group chain is enhanced with a two chain structure. Okay, it is only starting. Is that over the time we do not know how many multiple chains are going to be there in the blockchain. And bonus and deposit into the incentive mechanism for the group chain to regulate behaviors of leader groups, effectively prevent malicious nodes from joint attacks. The Bitcoin security and mitigates attacks against the Bitcoin blockchain such as selfish mining. So selfish mining is something like if the authorities who are involved in between are delaying the process of the blockchain growth, it is called selfish mining. So here what happens if he is delaying the growth, so obviously somebody else will come and join. Therefore this is something like a selfish mining. And the key blocks are generated via the proof of work to choose a leader, keeping the same block interval as in Bitcoin. A leader is allowed to generate micro blocks without the proof of work. The Bitcoin requires K confirmation to guarantee transaction security in case of attacks. So it requires K confirmation to guarantee transaction security in case of attacks such as double spend and selfish mining, which brings longer transaction confirmation delay. This is what the leader, it has the limitations. Therefore you can have a different structure. That means we have the simple data structure for your blockchain which you are familiar. That means we have the block 0, block 1, block 2 and so on, block n. Each block has the transaction 1, transaction 2, transaction 3 and so on. And they are all linked together, and there is a nonce is there, and of course these transactions are linked by the Merkle root, and that in turn is connected to the next block and next block. Okay, so what is the key inside all the blocks? That means trust. That means you have the trustless system, but means of introducing this kind of blocks with this particular hash value. Okay, so this hash value is a, and of course it's a nonce, is a nonce in the sense it has a unique number. Okay, you cannot replicate, you do not have any other value equivalent to this. Okay, therefore they are all linked together. Therefore since it is a 256 bits are there, you see the complexity. This is going to be 2 power 256. 2 power 256 is very, very big number. You can have all the devices in the world, all the people in the world brought under this particular chain. Okay, that is why people have selected a very long one. Okay, and seeing the cloud and fog nodes and the end devices, this is the layered architecture. And there are end devices, maybe at our own place. Okay, now you want to transfer the data to the blockchain network, and of course there is there in the cloud that in between you have a fork nodes. Okay, fork node is again that network is a complex network. See the complexity. Computers are there, storage is there, switches are there, routers are there, ports are there, and so on. Okay, therefore, see the complexity of how their data are transferred from one place to another place and go to the cloud. And of course, cloud is a very, very, very big network. Okay, and they have the elastic nature. People can join, devices can join. Okay, and you can release the resources and acquire some resources that depends on the requirements. Okay, this is what we call as elasticity. Okay, therefore, now these devices, end devices, okay, they make use of the blockchain network to have a contract, okay, to have a trust, and finally deployment. Okay, therefore, I understand that anybody who make use of both IoT devices and blockchain network, they have a 100% trusted environment. So principles in terms of consensus protocol. That means now we have a group chain, okay, where we have open membership. In the IoT network, it is necessary to establish public permissionless blockchain to support the nodes joining or leaving at any time. That's what we call as an open membership. The efficiency point of view, fog computing itself is to meet the processing requirements of massive IoT data in a more efficient way. So we may be working with IoT at a laboratory level, but in the world, internet world, the IoT data which is coming out of the devices is very, 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 very far away to our imagination. Okay, all such kind of data transfer must be maintained in a consistent level. Therefore, there is a need for a consensus protocol for blockchain-based fog computing is supposed to be, where efficiency is a matter, fault tolerance is a matter, scalability is a matter, security is a final matter, which has to be taken care of, which is the principles in terms of the consensus protocol. Okay. So the group chain design is centered at the leader. That means you have large number of groups are there, members are there in the group. Therefore, you have a leader who is nothing but member zero. We can say member zero, and they have a broadcasting all these things. And you have the verification and the signing of your documents and collect the signature and file.